Mr. President.
Senator from Texas.
Mr. President, I think people are surprised when they come to Texas and find out how diverse a state it really is. Not everybody there looks like me or pronounces their last name the same way. In fact, we are a huge melting pot of people from all over the country and literally many from around the world who come to the state because we are a growing economy and creating jobs and opportunity, and people can find work to provide for their family and achieve their dreams. So it shouldn't surprise anybody that Texas is increasingly diverse, and we've benefited a lot from the variety of folks and cultures and ideas that have come around the world and planted roots in the Lone Star State. When I ask folks if they know what the second most spoken language in Texas is, they say, well, that was easy, it's Spanish. I said, well, that's right. Well, let me give you a harder one. What's the third most commonly spoken language in Texas? And after a couple of guesses, they're usually surprised when I say Vietnamese. Now, it's not in the overall numbers of Spanish or English, to be sure, but we have a vibrant Vietnamese community in Texas that was established after the fall of Saigon and the Vietnam War. Many of them immigrated to the Houston area or to the Metroplex area. But of course, they faced many of the same struggles as those who've come to America throughout our country's history. In addition to adjusting to a new home, language, and culture, they dealt with some ugly aspects of their new home, racism and bigotry. But from those challenges and overcoming those challenges, they derived tremendous strength, demonstrated outstanding drive and a desire to succeed. Our Vietnamese American communities in Texas are growing and thriving, and they continue to play a very important role in our increasingly diverse state. I had the chance to meet with a number of my Vietnamese American constituents during the August break and talk about some of the issues that concern them the most. Just last weekend, in fact, I visited Cali Saigon Mall in Garland, Texas, for the annual Children's Festival. I participated in an on-stage discussion with a number of community leaders, and though the children seemed more interested in the tiger dance or musical performances and the colorful costumes, it was a great opportunity for me to hear from these folks firsthand. And we had a serious discussion about the human rights climate in Vietnam, which has continued to decline. The Vietnamese government limits political freedom by denying its own citizens their right to vote in free and fair elections. It denies them the freedom of assembly and expression and due process rights, the sort of basic rights that we call human rights here in the United States. Last year, one of my constituents, a young man named William Nguyen, was unjustly beaten and detained for participating in demonstrations in Ho Chi Minh City. We were fortunate enough to secure his release back home after the government convicted him on trumped-up charges, and I was glad to welcome him back to the good old U.S. of A. But sadly, the people who continue to live in Vietnam have no escape from a brutal communist regime which continues to disregard the most basic human rights, threaten religious freedom, and silence the press. Vietnam remains one of the lowest-ranked countries in the world when it comes to freedom of the press. In 2018, Reporters Without Borders ranked Vietnam 176th out of 180 countries worldwide. It should come as no surprise that Vietnamese Americans who've lived under this type of rule, or who have family members that still do, don't take our freedoms here in America for granted. Just the opposite. These immigrants are great patriots who fully appreciate the freedoms they enjoy here in America because they realize how close they came from seeing those same freedoms denied in their home country. And with them, I share concerns their concerns about the rising interest here at home and failed ideas like socialism, and will continue to dispel rumors that socialism could provide more than the free enterprise system, which has created the very prosperity that Vietnamese Americans and other immigrants enjoy here in the United States. In addition to our efforts to strengthen our own democracy, we need to do more to strengthen democracies around the world and to protect basic human rights. Earlier this year, I reintroduced the Vietnam Human Rights Sanctions Act to try to do just that. This bill would provide or would impose travel restrictions and other sanctions on Vietnamese nationals complicit in human rights abuses against their fellow citizens. These sanctions would not be lifted until the Vietnamese government releases all political prisoners and stops the use of violence against peaceful demonstrators. We simply can't avert our gaze and allow these practices to continue without any sort of accountability. And I would say the same for what's happening now in Hong Kong. I appreciate the many Vietnamese Americans who have shared their experiences with me on this topic, and I'll continue to advocate for a brighter future for the people of Vietnam. Mr. President, on one other matter, I want to take a moment to recognize a member of my staff who is nearing her retirement, Sandy Edwards. Sandy is the regional director in my Austin field office, but she's been with me for nearly two decades, first in my office when I was Attorney General of Texas, now in the United States Senate, where she serves, as I said, as my Central Texas Regional Director. Everybody that knows Sandy knows she has the heart and spirit of a public servant. She works hard to make sure that every Texan who contacts my office feels appreciated, understood, and is happy with the support they receive. She knows that our faces represent what people get for their tax dollars. And with Sandy, Central Texans have gotten some serious bang for their buck. Over the years, she has, of course, developed countless relationships with people and organizations who are working to improve our Texas communities in Central Texas. I'll never forget one year spending a December evening out in East Austin at an incredible nonprofit called the Community First Village. We joined formerly homeless people for a Christmas tree lighting and spent a cold, rainy night with them, rejoicing at what this organization and the good-hearted people who work there have helped them to achieve. At one point in 2012, Sandy had me biting down on a Starburst candy so that students attending Girl Start summer camp could analyze my dental impression. I never got a report back exactly how that turned out. But Sandy's not a fair-weather friend. She's also been by my side during some very difficult times. For example, in 2009, following the horrific shooting at Fort Hood, she was there as I fought to find words to provide even an ounce of comfort to the grieving post and the families there. We paid our respects to these American heroes and watched the ramp ceremony as their flag-draped caskets were loaded into a C-17 for their flight to Dover. Then there was 2013 in West Texas. That's not the region, that's the name of the city, following a massive fertilizer plant explosion. It tore through a tight-knit community and claimed the lives of 15 people, including most of the town's volunteer fire department. Sandy, of course, was on the ground, as she always is, helping to connect with the first responders and local officials, making sure they had the support that we could provide from our office. She was there during the Bastrop fires in 2011, the Wimberley flooding in 2015, and a deadly hot air balloon crash in Maxwell, Texas in 2016. Sandy's been a gracious helping hand during the tough times and an enthusiastic cheerleader during the good ones. I'm sorry to lose such a devoted staffer and friend, and I know my team in Texas will miss her big-hearted participation in our team effort. But I don't think there is really a coincidence that Sandy chose the month of September to retire because, of course, this is the start of her beloved Texas Longhorns football season. So I know she's looking forward to attending UT games this fall, along with her husband, Stan, and perhaps her son, Kyle, and his wife, Brittany. And I know for sure she'll enjoy spending more time at her family's ranch in the Texas Hill Country. So, Madam President, I wanted to come here to the Senate floor to publicly express my appreciation, as well as that of my entire staff, and I would dare say every single Texan who ever met her, to thank Sandy Edwards for the lives she's touched and made better. And I want to say thank you, Sandy, and wish you a well-deserved next chapter in your life.